Hello, everybody, and thank you for coming tonight. I think we'll get started. Hopefully, we might have more drop in. The weather probably affected some of our audience tonight. Our featured speaker is Steve Rolfsmeier. He is the director of the High Plains Herbarium here on campus. Steve is actually a Nebraska native. He comes from a small town around Seward, Nebraska. And oddly, he was not interested in plants until his senior year in high school, and obviously has since become quite interested. Steve received his undergraduate degree at Doan College and his master's degree at the University of Nebraska. Tonight, he is going to talk about the secrets of Sandhills. So please join me in welcoming Steve Rolfsmeier.
Thanks, Sean. Y'all can hear me fine? Okay. Actually, I think a lot of the people, there's not that many people here tonight. I saw about a ton of people over at the pancake supper. So apparently, nothing can stop people from getting pancakes. Keep that in mind next time you have one of these talks. So. This is a talk that's about a subject I've been kind of interested in for now about 15 years, and I've given a talk on this topic a number of times, but this is the first time I've done it in Chadron, which is kind of appropriate because I always open with this slide with the picture of, you know, some of you know who this guy is, Ron Whedon, down here in the corner. Ron was in large part a big encouragement and inspiration for doing this research. Ron was also my field assistant for a while, for a couple trips this summer. This is a picture I took of him out in the field collecting plants in the Sandhills with me, 2007. I like including this picture on here, first of all, because, you know, there's people here who know Ron and remember Ron. Ron was a dear friend and kind of an inspiration to a number of people. The other reason I like including this slide, because back when Ron was still alive and I would give this talk, I'd always start out saying, I'm going to be talking about relict floras. This is not the relict in question, which he got a kick out of. But I never took a class from Ron, but I knew him as a colleague and as a botanist and a prolific collector of plant specimens. Ron collected, oh goodness, over 10,000 specimens during his lifetime, and helped his students, in fact, collect probably at least twice that many. So the results of his life work, of course, is the herbarium, which I now am fortunate enough to be in charge of, Ron Whedon's legacy. And how many of you have been to the herbarium by chance? Some, you know, a few of you have. How many of you know what an herbarium is? Hopefully the ones who've been there would know. Okay, if you're not familiar with an herbarium, this is what an herbarium is. I got a couple of dictionary definitions from off the internet. A couple definitions. A herbarium is a source of primary data made up of dried and labeled plant specimens that are that are arranged in such a way that you can find them easily. Okay, when I talked about someone collecting a plant, what they do is go out into the field, dig it up, put it in a plant press to flatten it, dry it. Eventually, someone glues it to a piece of archival paper, along with a little note, a little label down in the corner, which tells you what the species is, where it came from, who collected it, whatnot. Lots and lots of information. We have 61,000 specimens in the herbarium. So that's a lot of information. The herbarium is essentially a library. Instead of the information, though, being in written form, it's in biological form. So this is one of the things I'm in charge of. Of course, our herbarium has a lot of more other collections than just plant collections as well. But this is what I spend my time on. The herbarium continues to grow rapidly. In fact, we're running out of space. You can see a lot of these boxes on the top are evidence of that. But a herbarium this size is something quite remarkable for a school the size of Chadron State. So you might ask yourself, that's great. What do you do with this herbarium thing? Well, there's a number of things. I could have a large list of what we do with the herbarium, but these are three of the more important things that we can use the herbarium data for. The herbarium, of course, is a resource for plant identification. Occasionally, someone will send you in a specimen of something that is so badly mangled or whatever, you really can't identify it unless you compare it to other specimens within the herbarium. So it's useful for identifying unknown plants. Of course, here at the college, we use it for teaching a lot. I have a couple of classes in which I have students go out and make collections, make specimens, and learn how to identify plants. So very important teaching resource. What I want to focus on for this talk, though, is the third point, documenting the presence of species at a particular place. And of course, those are data then that you can go ahead and put on a map. Okay, this map down here on the bottom, this is an excerpt from a book I was involved in. Here it is, quick plug for it. Flora of Nebraska, second edition. Tree has descriptions of 2,000 species of Nebraska plants, along with a lot of these little maps with dots on them. Every one of these dots you see on a map means somewhere in that county there's a specimen of a given species that is sitting in an herbarium somewhere. One of the things that really got me excited about plants was being able to put dots on map. You could go out and collect things and say, hey, that one there, that's my dot, really. That's kind of exciting. But another thing is that when I find that when I look at a map like this, I start asking questions. I start looking at things a little bit differently than I would if I didn't know what the bigger picture was. This is a map of a plant called Carduus nutans. Us botanists love to stick to those nasty Latin names. Anyone know what this is called? Here's a hint right here. The English name's right after it. It's called musk thistle. How many of you are familiar with musk thistle? Of course, you would be, Lucinda. It's a noxious weed. Not super common out here. There's a lot of other nasty weedy thistles that we might be more familiar with in this part of the state. But here's kind of a distribution you can see on this map. Musk thistles found all the way across the state, but there are a couple of gaps in this map you might notice. Notice right in this part, with the exception of the Platte Valley here, there's not records of it from the southwest part of the state and from the north central as well. Does that mean that there are no musk thistles in those counties? Well, I can tell you that, at least in southwest Nebraska, there's plenty of musk thistle. The reason we don't have it on the map is because we don't have a specimen from there. There are very few botanists and plant collectors in Nebraska, and a lot of space to cover. So things tend to be real well collected by where the botanists are. Up here in Chadron, Lincoln, Kearney, and a few other places. But other places are more or less terra incognita. This part of the state doesn't get a whole lot of botanical activity. Anyone know what this part of the state is called? Here's a clue. I'm going to talk about it in this talk. It's called the Sandhills. How many of you are familiar with the Sandhills? Most of you should be. Are there a lot of musk thistles in the Sandhills? Do you see them driving by? Well, no, not really. Musk thistles like kind of heavier soils, finer soils. The sandy soils in the Sandhills don't seem to suit them. I'm sure they're there. I don't know if they're all by your folks' place. Probably
down in the lower areas.
But in this particular case, this gap may actually be here because there just probably isn't a whole lot of musk thistle in the Sandhills. In fact, the Sandhills don't have a lot of weedy species in it, which is one of the nice things about them, especially if you get away from the roads and stuff. Okay, so sometimes when you see a gap in the map like this, that absence of evidence is not necessarily evidence of absence, as we like to say. Here's another empty county right over here. This is Sioux County. It's very close to us, pretty well collected, but no musk thistle dot from there. And I checked in our herbarium. We don't have a specimen of musk thistle from Sioux County. If you were the weed manager for Sioux County and you were expecting to, or your job it is to track down all the noxious weed, would musk thistle be something you'd expect to find that would be on your radar? Any ideas? Chris says, no. No, why not? But look at this. It's in this county, it's in this county, it's in all these counties surrounding it. And let's look at the bigger picture here quickly. Suppose we take it from beyond Nebraska and make a sort of a national map. All the pink you see here are occurrences of musk thistle in that county. Pink means it's a noxious weed in those states. It's all over Wyoming. It's all over South Dakota. I'm going to guess it's probably in this county. Odds are if every county surrounding Sioux County has it, pretty good chance that it's there. Just no one has collected it. May not be real common, but there it is. So once again, these maps can bring up questions. So that was the first example. Okay, I've got another one for you. How many are familiar with this plant, the Ohio buckeye? Okay, say what you like about Ohio State University. I have to commend them for using a plant as their mascot as a botanist. So if we look at this map, green means this is a plant is native in this area. Here's its native range. Just gets into Nebraska. The yellow color means it's something that might be kind of rare here. It just barely gets into this corner here. But look over here in Sioux County, no musk thistle, but Ohio buckeye. What's going on with that? Do you think maybe it's just all through the state and we're not seeing it? Well, it's kind of a conspicuous plant. It's, believe it or not, it's a close relative of the maples. It doesn't look like a maple. Here the leaves are, big tree, big pretty flowers, bigger, better flowers than you get on most of our maples around here. And of course, these enormous seeds, which are not much good for anything other than maybe throwing at someone. Plant that you're not likely to overlook. If it came up in your backyard, you'd probably see it. This occurrence of it in Sioux County is way out of its natural range. There's a special term we use for that. We say it's disjunct. One of the things that I like looking at is disjunct species and trying to figure out what's going on there. Any ideas on why it might be out there? Yes, Kurt.
Ohio State graduate moved out there.
I hadn't considered that, but that probably is it. It does appear to me that it was introduced intentionally. It was on a ranch. I found this in 2012, just before the fires. It was funny, we're out having lunch and I saw these weird little plants with these funny leaves and it just could not register with me that there might be Ohio buckeye on the Pine Ridge. Until walking back, we ran into a huge colony of it. And if you find it in southeast Nebraska, it never gets bigger than this tall, but it's tons of it out there, huge ones. So for some reason, it likes Sioux County quite a bit, but it never ever figured out how to get there on its own. There's some other plants like that too. How many of you have been to the Cliffs picnic grounds last few years? One of the trees you see there is black walnut. Also not native, but it's just taken over. Loves that country, but for some reason, never found its way out there until someone introduced it. So anyway, example of a disjunct species, something outside of its main range. It has escaped from cultivation and seems to be naturalizing just fine in Sioux County. So that's kind of interesting. So one more quiz question, one more, and we'll move on to the talk. Here's your last puzzle. This is paper birch. This is another familiar tree species. Chris knows all about paper birch. This is one you can even spot in the winter because of its white bark. You look at this map, you kind of think, well, there's a bunch of it here, there's a bunch of it here, and there's kind of these scattered dots here. Is this a disjunct distribution? It's hard to tell. You know, the reason being that, you know, you might have just one tree in Cherry County with one branch hanging over the county line, and we'd still count it as being in that whole county. Here, take a look at this. This is an earlier map someone did that was a little more precise. Instead of just shading in counties, they drew very precise boundaries based on herbarium specimens. Here's the main range of paper birch to our north. If you look down here in the corner, lots of little tiny dots in the Black Hills, the Central Niobrara down on the Front Range, and a few other places as well. How did the birch get there? Any ideas? Yeah, please.
It was always there, and the climate changed. And
you see, you should be taking my ecology class. You would be acing it. Very good. I think that's absolutely true. there's two ways to explain disjunct distributions. Something was in its native, the main range, and then kind of went somewhere else, but as Kurt just mentioned here, you can have the opposite situation, where the main range just kind of moved and left the plant behind. The places where you find paper birch in the plains are in very deep protected wet canyons, where they've managed to hide out and escape from fire, hot southerly winds, and other things that would usually fry a northern tree species like that. In fact, you'll notice there's a dot here in Sioux County. In the Pine Ridge area, we have two paper birches, two actual trees. Actually, now we just have one. Last summer, I've been looking for a few years now for, we have a record of paper birch in Monroe Canyon. I spent the last couple of years looking for it, finally found it this year. Here it is laying dead on the ground. We're down to one paper birch. Long-term prospects for paper birch in the Pine Ridge are probably not very good, but there's a lot of them in the Black Hills and in a few other places in this area as well. Why would these birches be here? Or when, why, what do you think caused them to come here in the first place? Any idea? Actually, they've been here for quite a long time because it's believed that it was actually because of glaciers that these things moved. Originally, they would have been up in Canada like this. At one time, this was mostly covered with ice. They wouldn't have been growing there at that time. Instead, the main range probably came right through here. So climate changed, the range expanded northward, left a few little disjuncts behind. There's a special name for that. These are relics, what we call relic species, species that are in a restricted area, but used to be more widespread. Things that are kind of hiding out in isolated areas. One of the reasons we are pretty sure that the ones in the Pine Ridge are relics and not introductions is the fact that there's a lot of other species that show that same pattern. The Pine Ridge area where we are at is loaded with relic species. Lots of things from the north and especially lots of things from the Rocky Mountains that are out of range here. Really awesome place to be if you're a botanist. The Pine Ridge contains relic species that, if you want to put it technically, are more typical of boreal, meaning Arctic northern, and Cordilleran, meaning Rocky Mountain areas. So in other words, we have a little bit of the Rocky Mountains in our backyard here. So what we just went through is a little introduction to a topic which I like to call the queen of the outdoor sciences, biogeography. It's a big deal. Linnaeus wrote about biogeography. Darwin did. Some geologists like Charles Lyell. In fact, the whole field of ecology owes its existence to people looking at maps and asking, why does that particular thing grow in that particular place? Technical definition for biogeography: study of distribution of species and ecosystems in space and time. Okay, that time element is where geology comes in. For instance, if you look at distributions of some of these four-legged critters, these are animals, as far as I know. Glossopteris is a plant, but these little animal distributions have these strange patterns on these different continents in the southern hemisphere. They don't make much sense until you move the continents around and put them together like this. In fact, biogeography was the first thing that tipped us off to the whole idea of continental drift. It was the biologists who were onto that, actually before the geologists were on it. They really didn't come around to accepting that until about the 1960s. So that's one of the aspects of biogeography. Another one is mapping floras, mapping groups of floras. For instance, here's a map of the floras of Europe. Here's the boreal flora of Europe right here. Of course, we have boreal flora in North America. Lots of the same species on both continents, actually. You can do this on a number of different scales as well. You can map ecosystems at a continental scale. You can also, of course, do it at a state scale. Here's a state map of what we call ecoregions, which are kind of like different types of ecosystems. The Pine Ridge shows up right here. And of course, the one that I'm going to talk to, which takes up so much of the middle of the space, the Sandhills, is another area that has patterns of species distribution within it that haven't been explored until relatively recently. So let's go ahead and introduce you to the Sandhills as if they needed an introduction. 20,000 square mile area of semi-arid grassland, basically sand dunes that are not moving around like sand dunes are wont to do because the vegetation is holding them in place, but it wasn't always like that. There's evidence that as recently as 5,000 years ago, most of the Sandhills were an unvegetated bunch of sand. Big piles of sand dunes moving around all over the place. It wasn't until about 5,000 years ago that they stopped moving and became grassland. In fact, there's actually evidence that they have done a little bit of misbehaving since in the last 5,000 years as well. Whenever we have a long period of drought, say 20 years or so, they start moving again. The last one of these was somewhere between 500 and 1,000 years ago. I don't know how many of you heard the Nebraska climate report when they released that, which was kind of grim sounding. It sounds like in the next 50 years we could see moving again. But for now, a stabilized dune field has 600 native plant species in it. Okay, just to give you an idea of what that number means, in Dawes County we have about 900 plant species. Probably more than 600 of them are native. In Nebraska we have close to 1,600 native species. For an area this big, that's not a whole lot of species diversity, but for a dune field, that's a lot of species. Once again, dune fields are just big piles of sand. Not a lot of stuff likes growing on piles of sand. So the Sandhills are actually kind of unique because they have a lot more species than your typical dune field. And one of the reasons for that is because a lot of the area in the Sandhills are wetlands. And wetlands have some different species associated with them that you wouldn't normally see in grasslands. In fact, there are some very interesting wetlands that occur in parts of the Sandhills that have organic soils. By organic soil, I mean the soil in these wetlands isn't sand, it's entirely made up of plant material. In particular, it's called peat. How many of you are familiar with peat? Yeah, Lucinda's giggling because she uses it all the time. What is peat? You're so smart, Lucinda.
Well, organic plant material.
Organic plant material that comes from nature. It comes from nature. It grows in what are called peatlands. And to put it in technical sciencey sounding terms, a peatland is simply a wetland where production exceeds decomposition. Okay, what that simply means is when the plants die, peatlands generally have lots of water in it. The water table goes right up to the surface. When the plant material goes into the water, it doesn't decompose very quickly. It just sort of stays there and forms peat. Now, the peat that you use commercially, this peat that Lucinda uses, most of that comes from bogs up in Canada. Most of the peat's actually made up of a moss called peat moss, naturally, genus Sphagnum. We don't have peat moss down here, instead we have what's called sedge peat. Sedges are the dominant plants in a lot of these particular peatlands around here. And the neat thing is, some of these deposits are rather old. If you do, someone at once actually went and took a core through Jumbo Fen in the middle of Cherry County, went all the way down to the bottom, found that the peat there was 22 feet thick. And once again, being organic material, you can carbon date this, the bottom of the fin, between 12 and 13,000 years old. Are you starting to see sort of a problem here? How old are the Sandhills? 5,000 years old. How do you get 12,000 years of deposition in the Sandhills? Another interesting thing is, since peat is uncomposed organic matter, it can also have other things in it as well, such as pollen. All the pollen that you find in the bottom layer of that, if you take it out and identify it, 70% of it is spruce. Are there spruce in the Sandhills? There are not native spruce anywhere in Nebraska. what's going on? Apparently it seems at one time the Sandhills must have been, well, maybe a spruce forest. Probably didn't look a lot like this though. This was a montane spruce forest. Looked a little bit different. In fact, some people have put together an ecosystem map of what we think things looked like 12,000 years ago. Right here where the Sandhills are, you have to the south what's called dry steppe. Okay, that would be prairie that we would have around Chadron. Just to the north, we have spruce parkland. Right where those two things met, you would have had something that looked like the hills around here, only with patches of spruce all over it. We don't have anything like that now. But it was a different thing. Look at this whole area right here. 12,000 years ago was a big layer of ice. If you have a big layer of ice just next door, that kind of changes the climate and makes things a little different. So even though the spruce is gone from back then, there are some other plants that are typical of those boreal fen habitats that are still sticking around. Here's a couple of them right here. I picked a couple of showy ones. This one's the one called bog buckbean. It's a boreal species, shows up in the Sandhills, but way out of its main range to the north. It's called buckbean, but it's not actually a bean. This one here's another one that shows up in fens. Another pretty called marsh marigold, not even closely related to a marigold. You can see why botanists don't like to use common names. But the fact is, even though we've had these pretty pretties hiding out in these little fens in the Sandhills for all this time, no one really kind of understood the significance of these plants until just recently. In fact, we didn't know there were fens in Nebraska until the 1980s. And actually, unfortunately, it wasn't even Nebraska botanists who first found them. It was South Dakota botanists. They were investigating an area on the Nebraska-South Dakota border in the northern end of the Sandhills. Found a fen with all of these species. Once we started looking around in Nebraska, we found these things all over the place. And we really should have known we had fens earlier because there were folks who told us about this. Here's I'm going to talk about a good one of my botanical heroes here. This gentleman right here, Reverend John Mallory Bates. Doesn't look like it, but he's a botanist. You know why you can tell? You see how this picture is so blurry? Once he got done with his day job, he's undoubtedly going to run out and start collecting plants. Bates was an Episcopal priest. He was the rector at Grace Church in Chadron in 1891. He ended his career as the rector of another Graced Episcopal church in Red Cloud, where Willa Cather was one of his congregants. And in his spare time, he was a botanist. You could do this pretty easily back in the early 20th century, late 19th century as a botanist. In fact, a lot of our botanists in the late 19th century were priests. What Bates did is he kind of was a traveling itinerant preacher, went from one congregation to another, and of course, on the way from one place to another in the western part of the state, he would stop and collect plants, and he really liked sedges. So I know he's a good guy. How many of you are familiar with sedges? Sedges look like grasses, though they're not as pretty. They like wet places, they like cool places. There is one pretty one. This one here is called cotton grass. It grows in fens. Most of them aren't too photogenic though. But Bates put out a wonderful paper out 100 years ago about the sedges in Nebraska. One of the places where he was looking for sedges was a fen along Boardman Creek. He was so excited by it. He wrote this, "I have been the only visitor to this fen in 24 years, meaning since 1890. It is worthy of exploitation by the best." Unfortunately, the best botanists in the country did not take his advice. No one ever kind of went back to Boardman Creek, at least a botanist didn't, until about probably the 1990s. Once we found out we had fens, though, there was kind of a push to do some work on it. In 1996, I was involved in a survey where we surveyed six fens in Cherry County, 192 species, 15% of them sedges, lots of them boreal things that are way out of range. This is kind of interesting. Okay, we had actually, as I just mentioned, even though we had records of a lot of species that were way out of range. We didn't really seem to pay much attention to what was really going on with the flora of the Sandhills until relatively recently. So the Sandhills, of course, were active dunes until 5,000 years ago. So the plants that are in there had to have come from somewhere else, had to come from outside the Sandhills to come in there and stabilize things. If you start looking at the species that are in the Sandhills and seeing what their geographical ranges are, you can split them into three groups. Actually, these are the three major groups of plants in North America. I'll introduce you to them. Most of the plants that occupy the Sandhills today, undoubtedly this included the plants that came in and helped stabilize the dunes, are plants that are native to the Great Plains. Duh, that makes some sense. Sandhills are in the Great Plains. Naturally, the plants that are next door are going to be the first ones in there. In fact, if you drive through the Sandhills, you see a large number of Great Plains species. Here's an example right here. You know, this one, soapweed, yucca glauca. The origin of the Great Plains flora actually appears to be in the Mexican highlands. So we call the Great Plains element of the North American flora the southwestern element. Anyway, even though this is the most abundant type of plant in the Sandhills, there aren't a whole lot of species in the Sandhills prairie. Mixed grass prairie in the Great Plains is not a real species-rich habitat. We don't really have good numbers for how many species from each one of these groups is in the Sandhills. However, there is a paper for a prairie in the western Sandhills that's 2 square miles, has 200 species in it. All of the habitats there are upland sand dune prairies. So once again, not a lot of species. 600 native species in the Sandhills. Probably less than half of them are Great Plains species. So where did the rest of those species that occupy the Sandhills now come from? Well, some of them, of course, are those species that you find in fens I just mentioned. Here's the range of Calpha palustris, marsh marigold. Mostly northern, a little bit out of range here in the Sandhills. These things, apparently, there's records of these things being in the Sandhills for 4,000 years before the dunes started moving. So some of the flora in the Sandhills was stuff that preceded the Sandhills. How the fens survived the dunes blowing around is a big mystery. If you do a core through those peatlands, in addition to seeing layers of peat, you see layers of sand. So there are times when sand covered some of these fens, but somehow enough of it managed to stay uncovered that these plants could still survive those nasty periods. Once again, not a big contribution to the flora in terms of species numbers. We found 192 species in fens. I don't think more than about 15% of those are boreal relics. So once again, northern species are in the Sandhills, not a big part of the flora. Plains species, slightly bigger part of the flora. Most of the species diversity in the Sandhills actually comes from the east, what we call the Carolinian elephant element. And whereas you get fen species where it's really wet, prairie species where it's really dry, these are the things that are in the Goldilocks habitats between xeric and hydric conditions. That's a fancy way of saying dry and wet. One of those communities is something we call tallgrass prairie. In fact, the tallgrass prairie extends from the Midwest into the Sandhills, has a lot more species in it than the Great Plains prairie. So a lot of that eastern element includes tallgrass prairie species, including this lovely thing right here, western prairie fringed orchid. This was the species that Ron and I were looking for on that trip that I showed you on that first slide. The Valentine National Wildlife Refuge, which has a lot of these sorts of habitats, has a lot of species in it. Once again, there's a fen there. There's also upland dunes. But once again, when you have that eastern element, you add a lot more species to the flora. So there's a lot of eastern influence in the species that are occupying the Sandhills today. This is not the only place where this happens, though. We have the same thing going on in the Pine Ridge. One of the things that makes the Pine Ridge and the Black Hills kind of unique and is that in addition to having these Rocky Mountain species, we also have Eastern Forest species. This one here, familiar with this? This is the native columbine that's found in parts of Nebraska. This is disjunct out here. You might look at this map and think, well, wait a minute. Here's the main range and here it comes all the way across the northern part of the state. What do you think is going on there?
You drove Highway 20.
Well, that could be it. You would be surprised there are distribution maps where you do have a straight line right along the highway sometimes. What actually is going on is this is something that's found along the Niobrara River, probably to about Valentine, and then picks up here in the Pine Ridge from about Hayes Springs over into Sioux County. So a little bit of a gap there. It also grows in the Black Hills. So part of the diversity we have in Dawes County is also attributable to eastern species. In our case, it's eastern forest species. We also have a few eastern tall grass prairie species. There are not a lot of eastern forest species in the Sandhills. Why not? Because there's not a lot of forest in the Sandhills. So where did some of these eastern species come from? Some of them came from the tall grass prairie. Some of them we don't really know how they got there. Here's an example. This is something that I found on that trip with Ron back in 2007. It's a sedge. Yay, I love sedges. First sedge from the genus Rhynchospora that we ever found in Nebraska. It doesn't look like much, but it has this really kind of cool black head of flowers on it. It grows about yay tall. When I found this, I thought, wow, this is the first time it's been recorded in the Great Plains. The Great Plains flora at the time didn't list this species. That was real exciting. I looked in the literature and I found some crummy botanist found it in Kansas, of course, in 1994, but still, that's kind of impressive. Here's its range. Here it is in there. How do you explain that? I don't think anyone put it there. It's not the kind of thing you would plant. There are some other things like that too. Anyway, one of the other things about this particular species, it was growing in a habitat that wasn't particularly remarkable, which I'll get to in just a second. My slides are out of order, I'm sorry. When I was in Kansas for a while, I started looking at patterns of plants in eastern Kansas and found that a lot of the things in eastern Kansas were in the Sandhills as well. What you can't really see here is going on is there's a pattern here. You can't really tell. There's some plants that are east of the Flint Hills, some plants in the Dakota sandstone of the Smoky Hills that also then show up in the Platte Valley and in the Sandhills. And there are actual gaps, you know, in between each one of these patches. For a while, I kind of puzzled with how did these plants get from, say, here up to there? Did some geological research. I found out, this was news to me, that at the end of the Pleistocene, when the glaciers were melting, the Platte River had a different course than it did now. Instead of going down here and then suddenly turning up and around, it continued on this way through what is now the Little Blue River down into Kansas. At one time, we had a little dispersal corridor, a little highway, a river, which would have been pretty big at the time, that went directly from this area up to there. Problem solved, right? Species just traveled up the river. They like kind of wet and wettish habitats. There's one of them, Juncus marginatus, the example I showed here. It's a rush. It's closely related to a sedge. Not nearly as attractive, though. And where do you find these things in the Sandhills? Well, places like that. Unfortunately, the Sandhills, parts of the Sandhills are beautiful and very photogenic. The places where you find all the really interesting plants are totally boring looking. A lot of the plants we found that are out of range are in habitats like this. Pretty much flat if you look real closely. There's a little bit of undulation in these areas. There's what we call swell and swale topography. On the upper areas, we get tall grass prairie with lots of unusual species in it. And down in the valleys, you get lots of sedges and stuff like that. But not a whole lot of relief, but still a lot of species in these areas. A lot of these species, though, way out of their range. In their main range, a lot of these things are associated with stuff like oak savanna and other things in the southeastern U.S. Not a habitat we tend to have here, but there's one thing in common between the plants in the Sandhills and the plants in their native range, and that's that they both grow in acid soils. Acid soils are not common in the plains. The Ills I-page soils in the eastern Sandhills, though, do have acid reaction in the upper layer. So apparently these things have somehow managed to find a little place where there was soil that suits them just fine. How that happened, I don't quite know. So once again, as I mentioned, we didn't really understand what was going on here until just about the 1990s in terms of all these eastern species in the Sandhills. Once again, we knew about the northern species in the fens a little earlier. And once again, there were clues going on in the Sandhills for quite some time that there are some species there that just don't make sense in their distribution. Here's a map that was published in 1977 for this species here, Agilinus gattingeri. I think it has a common name, I'm not sure. Pretty little plant, found in eastern Kansas, disjunct in Holtz County up here. This was collected by Reverend Bates. And there's an 1880-something specimen in Lincoln, around the Lincoln area. Reason I included this is because I found it in 1987 and didn't quite realize the significance of it at the time. Me and my advisor were traveling on a road in the Sandhills near the Garfield-Holt County line. I leapt out to collect a bunch of pretties, brought them back. When I finally pressed them up and looked at them later, I found there were a couple little things in there that didn't look like the rest of them. I keyed them to this species, but I kind of hesitated. Sometimes when you're a botanist and you're identifying something unfamiliar, you kind of waffle on it, especially if it's something that's really far out of range. Yeah, maybe I didn't identify it right. So I kind of shoved it aside and figured, well, these are probably misidentifications. We probably don't really have this species in the state. When I spent some time in Kansas and became familiar with the species, though, I went back, looked at these specimens. By golly, they were both correctly identified. And furthermore, one of the species was mislabeled as to where it came from. I noticed if I picked up this specimen, if I lifted up the label underneath, there was a smaller label, the original label that the actual botanist that collected it originally put on it, said it was from Antelope County. Oops. Once I found that out, ran up here, started collecting it all over the place. So just in this little tiny area in the eastern Sandhills. Once again, no good evidence that it grows anywhere between here and there, but locally very common right there. What's going on with that? So, as I mentioned, we didn't really, even though there were some clues out there that we had some species that were pretty far out of their range in the eastern Sandhills, we didn't start figuring out what was going on until the 1980s. When people started doing work in the eastern Sandhills, traditionally that's an area that botanists haven't paid much attention to. 1983, a graduate student in ecology was working about right here, found a little white-flowered species of violet, didn't know what it was. Took it to my graduate advisor, who knew immediately what it was because he's from Minnesota, where this plant grows. He thought, well, isn't that remarkable? This is a plant that had never been recorded from the Great Plains before. We looked in the Herbarium in Lincoln, and there were specimens of it in Nebraska from the 1890s. No one had ever thought to look in that folder before to see whether it actually occurred in Nebraska. Recent survey shows that it's really common right in this little area. I've seen quite a bit of it just in that little spot, in those few counties. 1986, I threw this one in here because this was something, this was more of a personal one. 1986, I was on an Audubon Society field trip in the Platte Valley. This little prairie we were on was filled with this little tiny white flower. We weren't supposed to collect anything, but you know, bird people, it's very easy to sneak things past them. You know, look, a bluebird. So I took these things back, heated about 100 times, and it kept coming to this species that was also not in the Great Plains. Nearest locations were down here in Missouri. At the time, I thought, how can this be? I must have made a mistake. We sent it away to a specialist. He said, no, it's identified right. So over time, we slowly started gathering clues that there's some funny things in the eastern sandhills that are way out of their range. The floodgates finally opened in the late 90s. When we started looking for orchids, we had a colleague of mine who did orchid surveys in the eastern sandhills, hit the mother lode. Same area too, that same little spot. Had four species that were not recorded in the Great Plains. Of course, one of them is that violet we had earlier. This one right here was real remarkable, Xyrus tortoise, something called yellow-eyed grass. This is a family of plants that was never recorded in the Great Plains before. And look at its distribution. Here's its main range down in the Gulf Coastal Plain. What the hell is this doing up here? So, you know, this became kind of an interest of mine starting at about this point. I started, you know, paying attention to this. If you map all the species that are disjunct, you see a couple patterns. For one, the ones that are found in Kansas and Nebraska can all be pretty much found inside this red circle. The ones that are way, way, way out of range, though, are found only in a part of that circle, this blue part right here. When you start seeing a lot of species that are out of range, that all kind of have the main range somewhere else, you're kind of thinking, maybe this is a relict flora. Okay, about the time we, you know, I started getting into this, we moved to Kansas so Susan could work on her PhD. When Ron passed, I came back up here to take over for him. But of course, that meant I had to constantly drive between Chadron, Nebraska, and Manhattan, Kansas, where my family was situated. Every time we did that, I made a point of trying to drive through that blue circle as much as possible. And after I came back to Chadron for a while, it finally paid off. Helped kind of give me some idea what's actually going on here. 2011, I was busily doing one of my trips through the sandhills, going to all my favorite spots, trying to find these little relict species. Was running real behind, so I decided, hey, I'm going to skip a bunch of sites. I'm just going to head straight up to Highway 20, hit my one site there, and go to Chadron. So anyway, I drove on this road, this crappy road that nothing grows on of interest. I think it was up to Atkinson. And just about slammed on the brakes. I saw something out the window. It's one of those things, botanists do this a lot, slam on the brakes, throw it into reverse, and drive backwards down the state highway. It's the sandhills. You're not going to hit anyone. What I saw was a huge patch of yellow-eyed grass in the ditch, biggest patch I've ever seen. I thought, well, that's kind of interesting. You know, you don't see that every day. This is that yellow-eyed grass is one of those way out of range species. So I got out there, jumped out, and growing in amongst the yellow-eyed grass were a bunch of little sedges. Oh, I love little sedges. So I'm down on my hands and knees, looking around here, picking up sedges, and I start seeing these little tiny weird balls on a stick thing. This is about exactly what they looked like. Here's one I collected a month later just for size comparison. No leaves on this thing. I couldn't find any roots, just these little tiny inch tall sticks with these little balls on it. Wasn't a moss. Mosses only have one ball per stick. I'm teaching a moss class right now. Don't tell my students I use that terminology. It turns out that this thing, of course, I had no idea what this was. Never seen anything like it. Ran back to Chadron, tried keying it out. Didn't have even so much of a clue of what kind of an organism it was. Turns out this plant here, what little of it there is in full flower in this picture. If you dissect open this little thing, there's a flower inside there. The flower doesn't open all the way. There are some tricky flowers that have this habit called cleistogamy. They self-pollinate and the flower never actually breaks bud, makes fruit. This thing had both flower and fruit on it. I was able to identify it as a member of the genus Utricularia, which is a group of carnivorous plants. This little thing is carnivorous. Yeah, be careful holding on to it there. You would never know it. What was more remarkable, I went ahead, I keyed it to Utricularia subulata, one of those things, look, must have keyed it half a dozen times to make sure, because it's another thing that was way the heck out of range. Here's its main range is right along the Gulf. So once again, this is just added to the list of strange plants in the eastern sandhills. But what happened next was kind of interesting, because naturally, you know, I found this thing, I had to tell everyone. I found Utricularia subulata, told it to my advisor. He told it to the guy in Kansas. The guy in Kansas told it to the guy who's working on this genus for the flora of North America. He responded to me and said, I don't think there's any way what he found was actually Utricularia subulata. It was probably this other species, Utricularia gibba, that's in Iowa. They're just hard to tell apart. Have him send me a specimen. I sent him two specimens, and I was right, of course. But the thing was, the guy who I sent them to, the specialist, was someone, he's based out of Michigan State University. So it occurred to me, you know, if you look at this map real quickly, let's look up here real close. What do you see right here in Michigan? There are some spots for this thing way the hell out of range. In fact, this picture came off the Michigan State Extension website. This guy's based at Michigan State. But it got to me thinking, well, what if maybe this site is a lot closer to the Sandhills than this down here, isn't it? What if instead of coming up from down here, this is a specimen that came from this direction, westward? It just happens to turn out that there's a lot of other species that have this kind of a pattern that are found in Michigan, Gulf coastal species that are way out of the range, a lot more than we have in the Sandhills. And since there's a lot more botanists in Michigan, people have actually looked at this problem. Going back to the 1920s, 1922, a botanist named Petey said what he thought happened. Well, the reason these things were up here was because when the glaciers melted, there were two drainage channels in the northeast US. One of them that went along the Great Lakes and into the Hudson Valley. The other one, of course, being the Mississippi. This guy thought that this drainage channel connects with the northern part of the Atlantic Plain. Maybe the species just hopped over from up here over into this area. Okay, that's all fine and good, but how do you explain how they get all the way to Nebraska then? Because there wasn't a drainage channel past the Great Lakes. But if you look at his map here, this is a map actually from a more recent paper by a guy named Resnicek. Resnicek is the sedge expert in North America, so you know he's got to be right about stuff. Look at the X's here. This is yellow-eyed grass. As you can see, it extends west of that drainage channel into isolated areas in Minnesota, Michigan, Illinois. Why not Nebraska? Maybe even Iowa. Why not Nebraska? When I was teaching ecology here and was talking about fens once, I ran across this slide on the internet. And I thought, this is a distribution of fens in the interior in North America. Isn't that an interesting pattern? Is it possible? There's such a thing called stepping stone dispersal. What that means is some plants might travel a long distance by going from one patch of suitable habitat to the next, to the next, and to the next. Problem was, these were fens. The species I'm looking at don't grow in fens, but they might grow in habitat associated with fens. In fact, this now raises some questions about where did our fen species come from? Maybe not Canada. Resnicek, though, pointed out some other things. He said, well, what about long-distance dispersal? Long-distance dispersal is where something goes from one area way somewhere else, and that can be kind of random. It could have come from anywhere. In fact, he pointed out in his paper he thought there were three species of little sedges that probably dispersed from the plains to the Great Lakes. Goodness sakes, if things can go in one direction, they certainly can go in the other, can't they? So it kind of thought in my mind, well, how would you test to see if the stuff we're seeing in the Sandhills came westward or came northward? Well, what I did is I started looking at a lot of distribution maps. These are three species in Resnicek's paper that he said are typical Gulf Coast species that are found in Michigan, but that are also found in the Sandhills as well. Okay, you'll notice here they are up in the Great Lakes area, but once again, all over in the Southeast Plains. If you look at enough of species that show this pattern, after a while, you start noticing that there seems to be two other areas other than the Sandhills that have the same species in it. One of them's the Great Lakes. One of them is this area down in East Texas. Okay, that's interesting. If all the species that we have here are either in this spot or this spot, maybe if we look at some other species, we can figure out where these things came from. So I started doing that. First off, I thought, well, what if we looked at species that occur in this area and in the Sandhills, but not in this area? What would that tell us? Here's some examples of species like that. Little tiny perennials that grow in sandy areas. This is Oenothera perennis. This is one of the ones that was new to the Great Plains that was found in the late 90s. Leckia stricta, very nondescript plant, but it's been known in the Sandhills for a long time. And look at these patterns. Once again, not in the Gulf Coastal Plain, but here it is in the Great Lakes, and then in Nebraska. Is this long distance dispersal? Probably not. These are species that are not very big. They have seeds that don't travel very far. A lot of plants have what are called gravity dispersal, meaning the seed falls off the plant and onto the ground. These are examples of that. These are really things that probably are not set up for long distance dispersal, but they could probably travel by stepping stone dispersal out to this area. So this is, okay, well maybe that northeastern pathway is one of the ways that some of these species traveled. What happens when you do the other pattern? Look at the stuff that's in the south but not the Great Lakes. Here's what I found. I could hardly find anything that fit that pattern. The only thing that kind of fit was this guy right here. Little tiny annual species found in wet areas. A lot of times, little tiny annuals that are found in wet species tend to travel pretty easily because of a phenomenon called dirty duck's feet. Species that grow where the ducks are have seeds that get attached to the duck. Duck travels northward. Of course, you probably are aware that there are some ducks that travel down the middle of the country northward at a certain time of the year. I'm guessing what we're seeing with this one is something like duck dispersal. And the reason I think that is because this shows up in a lot of other places other than the Sandhills too. In fact, you can find this plant growing over by Sugarloaf Butte north of Toadstool in a little tiny wetland that has water in it for maybe a month each year. Prime example of something that might have been spread by a duck. I tried desperately to find another example. This is as close as I could come up with, this little tiny annual bellflower. It's not even in the eastern Sandhills, but something else. Just was really kind of hard to find evidence to suggest that stuff from here came up from here. So there's some good evidence to suggest that when we're looking at these plants from the Sandhills, what we might be seeing is an outlier of stuff from the Great Lakes rather than from the Gulf Coastal Plain. So, like any type of research, usually you get more questions when you're done than answers. Are the disjunct plants in the eastern Sandhills from remnants of a more widespread flora? Did they slowly come up from the Great Lakes? Did they come up from the Mississippi drainage? When did this happen? And of course, how did these things survive all that blowing sand? Questions I still haven't approached. So thanks for sticking with me. I'm almost certain I ran over, Sean. Thank you. And if you want to stick around a few minutes, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Go ahead. I'd like to know about the acid soils that occur not in just part of the soil profile. Is that what you were describing?
Yeah, one of the things you see is that where you have sandy soils, you oftentimes have kind of an acid reaction. They tend to be mineral poor soils. The Dakota sandstone, which outcrops in parts of southeast Nebraska, has extremely acid soils. A lot of places, hardly anything will grow in it. You can also get acid soils in sand where you have a high water table. I'm not actually understand exactly how the chemistry goes, but in parts of the places where you get these things in the eastern Sandhills have a fairly high water table, maybe a meter or two down. And from what Matt has told me from his experiences, Matt Brust is our zoologist who also is very interested in biogeography, is that elsewhere, like places like Wisconsin, you get acid soils in those same sorts of situations. Okay. But of course, most other sands in the Sandhills and everywhere else are calcareous because we used to be, you know, the bottom of an inland sea, lots of calcium carbonate. So acid soils are kind of unusual here.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes?
Do you know that tiny little carnivorous plant?
Mm-hmm.
What does it ingest?
That's a very good question. You know, there is another species of that same genus that's actually pretty common in the Sandhills. Most of them are aquatic. The leaves float around in the water, but they've never figured out how to pollinate in the water, so the flowers stick up on a stalk. If you take that thing out of the water and you look really closely, the leaves are very dissected and feathery looking, but in amongst them there's these little tiny round bladders. These things are called bladderwort. And it's kind of neat. There's these little, it's like a little sac formed by a little piece of leaf. It's got digestive enzymes in it, and a little lid on the top, and a little trigger. What happens generally is a little copepod or some other tiny thing that's in the water comes too close, sets off the trigger, opens up the bladder, the surface tension sucks it in, closes it back up. Now the odd thing was this plant I found in the Sandhills, which is also carnivorous, didn't have any leaves on it. And apparently elsewhere where it grows, I for some reason get the impression that it somehow has these bladders underground. This is growing in an area with really high soil water, so it might be the little critters that live in the soil that it was eating. Hard to say. Did you have a question?
It's moving from the Great Lakes into the eastern Sandhills. Do we have any idea when they arrive or how long they've been in the eastern Sandhills?
Boy, not really. In that paper that was done on the Great Lakes stuff, this consensus seemed to be that it was sometimes, of course, after the glaciers melted, when the Great Lakes started receding. Of course, when you have glaciers, you have, actually, it doesn't work quite that way. The Great Lakes should have been higher, I think. But that would have put it probably about the same time as we saw the fens forming, 10 or 12,000 years ago. Now, if they came up there first and then traveled across, it might have been a little bit later. Of course, the possibility was that all those areas might have been connected when there was drainage from the glaciers melting. We really don't know, and we don't have any good way of knowing. The geologists who do the stuff with the fens where they try to find out the age, I've been trying to get them to work in the eastern Sandhills, but so far no luck. But I could only speculate.
Long predate human migration?
Well, I think it certainly does predate human migration. And the fact is, if you ever travel in the eastern Sandhills, a lot of the areas there are not covered with dune sand. Some of what you get are what are called sand sheets, and some of that sand sheet might have stayed pretty stable for quite a while. In fact, the places where you do get these disjuncts are oftentimes found in valleys between dune ridges, where the sand dunes just for some reason never got there. So eastern Sandhills seems to have more of that stuff because it wasn't as deeply covered by sand as the western Sandhills. So, anything else?
Have you been to Long Pine in that area?
Yes, I was just there this summer and I found beautiful boreal mosses way out of range there. It's another one of those places that has, in fact, Charles Bessie, the great botanist from Nebraska, wrote a paper about Long Pine. It's a real crossroads. You have eastern forest species, western stuff, mosses that grow in the boreal forests of Canada all in one spot.
It feels like you drop down into the land that time forgot, kind of, to me. And you go down, you're driving along the hills, and it's just down.
Oh, yeah, that's one of those things. You're driving along on the table, and then suddenly, big old Pine Canyon in here. By land of time forgot, I thought you were maybe referring to that guy who shoots at people who go rafting on the creek there. Got to be kind of careful around there sometimes.
I hope not.
All right. Anything else? Okay. Thank you very much for showing up and for your questions and for sitting through it.
Where was that?
On the internet.
There are lots of those roads.
Yeah, if you type pictures of, you know, Sandhills, and do, you know, the ones that you, that aren't copyrighted, most of the ones that come up look just like this. These gorgeous venues of these tracks. Of course, you know, the etiquette in the Sandhills is that you're supposed to, you can drive 60 miles an hour down these roads, but they're only one lane. So if someone's coming the other way, you pull off to the side here, but you keep going 60 miles an hour. That's how you're supposed to do it. All right. Okay, that's all I got. So thanks for coming.